morning before he convened the Senate and invited me to pray. He blessed us by striving to do your will. Lord, he consistently upheld the standards of excellence, civility, and accountability. Inspired by this long and consequential life, may our lawmakers seek to faithfully and obediently honor you. And Lord, we continue to intercede for Ukraine. We pray in your sovereign name. Amen.
Please join me in reciting the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Under the previous order, the leadership time is reserved. Morning business is closed, and under the previous order, the Senate will proceed to executive session, resume consideration of the following nomination, which the clerk will report.
Nomination, Federal Reserve System, Lael Brainard of the District of Columbia to be Vice Chairman of the Board of Governors.
Mr. President.
The Senator from Hawaii.
I note the absence of quorum.
The clerk will call the roll.
Ms. Baldwin.
President. Are we in a quorum call?
We are in a quorum call.
I ask consent the quorum call be suspended.
Without objection. Majority whip is recognized.
Madam President, last week, America and Illinois lost a hero. Lorenzo Cervantes was his name. He'd been a steel worker living in the small town of Sterling, Illinois, in the Rock River Valley. That's an hour or two west of Chicago. Mr. Cervantes was 98 years old. When he was a young man, he set out to save the world. He joined the United States Army in February of 1943 during World War II, before he'd reached the age of 20. He was a member of an elite group. It was an American-Canadian commando unit known as the 1st Special Service Force. Top secret, band of brothers, operating deep behind enemy lines. The Forcemen, as they were known, earned the nickname the Devil's Brigade from terrified Nazi soldiers and officers who said that they seemed to appear out of nowhere in the dead of night like devils. That unit he served in suffered one of the highest casualty rates in the war. Listen to these figures. Of the 2,400 men who fought with the unit, 2,300 of them were either killed or wounded. But they never lost a mission, not one. The 1st Special Service Force existed for only 2 years, but the spirit of that force lives on in the Green Berets, Army Rangers, Navy SEALs, Marine Raiders, Canadian Special Operations Regiment, and frankly, all of today's military special forces. For decades after World War II, the very existence of that unit remained top secret and classified. The Forcemen didn't tell anyone what they'd done in the war, not even their families. Like Lorenzo Cervantes, they quietly returned home, married, raised families, and lived ordinary lives. In 2015, some 70 years after the end of World War II, they were finally honored for their service when Congress awarded them the Congressional Gold Medal. I had the privilege of meeting two other Forcemen from Illinois at that gold medal ceremony. Casey Selsky was one of them. He fought with the Devil's Brigade at the Battle of Anzio, one of the Allies' greatest surprise victories. He was among the first Allied soldiers to enter Rome and liberate it from the Nazis. Mr. Selsky died 3 years ago, also aged 98. After the war, he'd returned to Illinois and married. He and his wife had 11 children. 11. In 1995, 50 years after the war ended, Mr. Selsky and one of his sons decided to go back to Europe to take a look and see the places where the 1st Special Service Force had fought and to visit the towns that the force had liberated. Near the Anzio beachhead, they spoke to an Italian man. When the man realized who they were, he dropped to his knees, broke out in tears, and thanked Casey Selsky of Illinois. The Italian man said to his son, "This is one of the soldiers who saved our village." Casey Selsky turned to his son and said, "All these years, I wondered what I was doing. Now I know." After World War II, the United States and the leading free nations of Europe worked together to create a new system of rules and institutions to guard the peace of World War II and to reduce the risk in Europe that we would ever again descend into the hell of war. The most important of these new institutions was called the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, NATO. Among its most important new rules was the commitment that nations must never again wage wars of conquest against their neighbors. For more than 75 years, the new rules and institutions largely helped keep the peace in Europe. But then came Ukraine. With its barbaric attack on Ukraine, Russia is waging war not only against a sovereign nation, an innocent, unprovoked nation. Russia is attacking the very system of democracy and rules-based order for which 400,000 U.S. service members died in World War II, and many more have given their lives since. Vladimir Putin is seeking to restore some mythical Russian empire. He wants to demolish NATO, and he wants to drag the world back into a blood-soaked past when kings and tyrants waged wars of conquest to expand their territory and fill their coffers. As Russia's barbaric, bloodthirsty war against Ukraine enters its third month, it is clear that Vladimir Putin has miscalculated disastrously. He thought his forces were so overwhelming that he would occupy Kyiv, the capital of Ukraine, in a matter of days, that he would remove Volodymyr Zelensky from his power in Ukraine, and that he would install a puppet government that once again take orders from Moscow. Instead, Kyiv still stands. Zelensky is still in control, and Vladimir Putin has been frustrated by the determination, courage, and resiliency of the Ukrainian troops. He has suffered heavy losses. Russia has lost the battle for Ukraine to date. Vladimir Zelensky is still Ukraine's president, and Russian forces are demoralized and depleted. Instead of seizing Kyiv and all of Ukraine, Russia is now regrouping to try to pick one region that they can conquer, the Donbas region, which they've illegally occupied since 2014, and to seize the Black Sea port of Mariupol. Russia's economy is increasingly staggering under the weight of some of the most powerful sanctions ever levied against any nation in the history of the world. The effect of these sanctions against Russia will become even more onerous in the months ahead, as Russia is unable to buy parts and equipment to keep its basic industries thriving and other key sectors of its economy functioning. The sanctions also target the oligarchs, the kleptocrats, Putin's fraternity, who've helped prop up his corrupt regime. They're losing their super yachts. Isn't that a heartbreaker? Their vacation dakas, and some are starting to lose their lives, a fate that seems to befall a strange number of people who get close to Russia's KGB thug, who happens to be the leader in Russia today. The Russian government has given up any pretense it once had after the breakup of the Soviet Union of ever becoming a democracy. I say that with some sadness for the people of Russia, that they have been relegated to the role of pawns in Putin's escapade. A new censorship law has taken effect. It makes it a crime punishable up to 15 years in prison to even describe the invasion of Ukraine as a war, or to describe Russia's assault on Ukraine in honest terms. You can go to prison for that in Mr. Putin's Russia. It was just a few weeks ago I met upstairs in my office with a Russian journalist and opposition leader. His name is Vladimir Kara-Murza. Mr. Kara-Murza is fearless. He survived poisoning attempts by the Kremlin twice. He told me several weeks ago, "I'm going back." I said, "Why?" He said, "There's work to be done." He told me about his opposition to Russia's war in Ukraine, the increasing opposition to the war with Russia, and his hope that one day Russia will end be part of the community of democracies. Well, Mr. Kara-Murza went back to Moscow, and last week he was arrested. The same day, CNN broadcast an interview in which he called Putin's government a regime of murderers. Mr. Kara-Murza faces years of imprisonment for simply telling the truth. Senator Marco Rubio of Florida and I are going to introduce a bipartisan resolution this week calling for Mr. Kara-Murza's immediate release. I hope my colleagues on both sides of the aisle will join us. Vladimir Putin also badly miscalculated the unity of NATO and the will of free people to defend democracy. Instead of shattering NATO, Putin has strengthened NATO. Finland and Sweden, longtime neutral nations, could soon join NATO. Germany's pursuing a historic, dramatic overhaul of its approach to security and defense. And yesterday, French voters re-elected their president, Emmanuel Macron, decisively choosing him over his far-right Putin sympathizer, Marine Le Pen. That election in France marked the first time in 20 years that French voters have given a president a second term. It's widely viewed as, among other things, a vote of support for NATO and Ukraine and against Putin and his Russian aggression. Vladimir Putin also gambled that America would be too weak and divided to oppose Russia's assault on Ukraine. Badly mistaken again. Republicans and Democrats are standing together in support of Ukraine, as are the American people. President Biden's leadership has been critical in uniting NATO and the West and enabling Ukraine to defend itself. Yesterday, Secretary of State Antony Blinken and Secretary of Defense Lloyd Austin traveled to Kyiv and met with President Zelensky personally to show Putin and the world that the United States of America stands with the Ukrainian people in their heroic defense of their homeland. The U.S. is providing Ukraine with the military equipment to defend itself, but it takes the courage and determination of those men and women in Ukraine to make it work. In the last 2 months alone, America has committed to Ukraine an unprecedented $3.7 billion in military equipment, including howitzers, helicopters, ammunition, tactical drones, and more. Ukraine's armed forces are using this equipment, performing brilliantly. The coming weeks will be difficult. They may be decisive. In concentrating its assault on the Donbas, Russia is moving the war from cities like Kyiv and Kharkiv to a more wide-open landscape, where its heavy artillery seems to have an advantage. In addition, many intelligence reports suggest that Putin is desperate for something he can call a military win by May 8th, which Russia celebrates as Victory Day, marking the Allies' defeat over Nazi Germany in World War II. The tragic irony is that in this war, Russia is using many of the same tactics used in World War II, attacking a peaceful neighboring nation, intentionally targeting civilians, and committing heinous war crimes. This Senate voted unanimously last month to condemn Vladimir Putin as a war criminal. We must continue to stand with Ukraine and for democracy and for the rules of civilization, which so many Americans fought for and died in World War II and since. I started this comment on the floor this afternoon, remembering a World War II vet in Illinois just passed away at the age of 98, Lorenzo Cervantes. I've spoken to so many of those vets and said, "What were you fighting for?" And they said, "We were fighting for our buddies right next to us. We were going to bring each other home safely. So we kept the fight. And we were fighting for our families. We believed our family name was at stake, and the courage we showed would reflect on them. And we also were fighting for a nation, the United States, which we were proud to serve and risk our lives for. But most of all, we were fighting to make sure our kids didn't have to do the same. We were willing to sacrifice, even give our lives, so that our kids could live in a peaceful world." Well, for almost 80 years, that was a fact after World War II and the service of Lorenzo Cervantes and hundreds of thousands of others. And then came Vladimir Putin with this unprovoked attack on Ukraine. He thought they were a pushover. He had this massive Russian army, mobilized them over a span of months, ready to attack. And when he launched his attack, he expected the people of Ukraine to fold, quit, and leave. But they didn't. They fought, and they've been an inspiration ever since. Putin wants to write a new world order. He wants to say to the living veterans of World War II and their families, "You wasted your time. I can do this if I wish. I have the power." But he's run into a force he didn't anticipate. The Ukrainians have done an incredible job, an inspiring job to the world. And I want to, of course, say a word of praise to their president. Mr. Zelensky started in life as a stand-up comedian. Somehow or another, he's become the world's leading stand-up president, standing up to a tyrant like Vladimir Putin, inspiring people all around the world to join in this effort to save his nation. I'm glad that the United States is on board, and we will continue to help him until Putin is finally gone. The genocide which he's inflicting on the Ukrainian people is an embarrassment in the 21st century. To think that this could happen in the so-called civilized Western world is virtually unthinkable. We've got to make a stand, and I'm glad that we have, and I support President Biden and the NATO alliance for standing behind the people of Ukraine. Madam President, I yield the floor, suggest the absence of a quorum.
Clerk will call the roll.
Ms. Baldwin.
Madam Chairman.
Republican leader.
I ask consent that further proceedings on the quorum call be dispensed with.
Without objection.
As the Senate convenes today, we're mourning the loss of our dear friend and legendary former colleague, Orrin Hatch. When Senator Hatch retired 3 years ago, this body lost its longest serving Republican and its president pro tem. We also lost one of the kindest and best humored colleagues any of us had ever served with. And for that matter, the Senate's only former band manager of a Mormon folk music group. Orrin Hatch led an incredibly full, interesting, and accomplished life. By the end of his tenure, our very funny colleague liked to poke fun at his own longevity. I remember when Orrin, a former Judiciary Committee chairman, would pretend to wistfully recall his work on Justice Joseph Story's confirmation back in 1811. Humor aside, the reality was impressive enough. Orrin's dogged service for Utah and our nation was a constant in this chamber for 42 years. He was an accomplished, influential chairman of three major committees, Health, Judiciary, and Finance. He was an essential legislator behind a long list of landmark laws, from the Hatch-Waxman Law on Generic Drugs in the 1980s to the Americans with Disabilities Act, the Religious Freedom Restoration Act, and the State Children's Health Insurance Program, all back in the 1990s, all the way through to the historic 2017 tax reform that Orrin shepherded as finance chairman. That helped engineer the best economic moment for American workers and families in modern history. There were also countless specific achievements for the great state of Utah that Orrin loved so much. And amid all that legislative heavy lifting, Orrin was also a pivotal player concerning the Senate's part in the personnel business. Amazingly, at the time of Orrin's retirement, he had personally participated in the confirmations for more than half of all the Article III judges who had ever served in American history. Orrin came into the Senate as a young conservative firebrand. His first campaign for any public office of any kind was the 1976 campaign that landed him here. He left the Senate as a widely admired and universally liked elder statesman. His legacy is peppered with both big principal victories, bipartisan collaborations, and a roster of friends that span the entire political spectrum and sometimes transcended politics altogether. But there was never any confusing what Orrin viewed as his proudest accomplishment of all. That would be his remarkable marriage to Elaine and their loving family. Alphabetical order was perhaps never served any man better than when Hatch, Orrin was assigned the chair next to Hansen, Elaine in a Brigham Young University classroom. Decades later, Orrin said, "I can't remember a doggone thing from that astronomy class." But the two of them got 65 inspiring years of marriage and a big, happy brood of kids and grandkids, all out of the bargain. So today, the entire Senate stands with Elaine, the Hatch family, and the huge, huge network of friends, former staffers, and admirers that Orrin leaves behind across Utah and across our country. We mourn this great loss, and we honor this great life. Now, Madam President, on an entirely different matter, the Senate reconvenes today after Passover and Easter to begin a new work period. But unfortunately, the biggest problem facing the American people is still the same as it has been all year long. Rising inflation is continuing to inflict painful consequences on working families across our country. This painful problem isn't getting better. It's still getting worse. Last month, consumer prices clocked an 8.5% year-on-year increase. Inflation is now rising at its fastest pace in more than four decades. The surge is being led in large part by a 23.6% jump in airfares, a 35.3% increase in used car and truck prices, and a 48% spike in the cost of gasoline. These are exactly the sort of products consumers lean on most heavily in the warmer months. But while March's numbers are an extra cruel twist, the American people have been feeling the effects of the Biden administration's war on domestic energy for the better part of a year. Before most folks even began to consider summer travel, and long before Putin launched his invasion of Ukraine, working families were already facing soaring prices at the gas pump. Even as wage growth accelerated for a fifth straight month, workers' paychecks once again failed to keep pace with the steep surge of rising prices. Raises and bonuses are being swallowed by inflation. Real wages are down 2.7% year on year. Democrats' runaway spending has brought us runaway inflation. Prices in the U.S. have risen higher and faster than in other developed economies. Even the New York Times now admits, quote, risks are mounting that America's ambitious spending will end up with a checkered legacy. Let me say that again. Even the New York Times now admits risks are mounting that America's ambitious spending will end up with a checkered legacy. But even in the face of this painful reality, even as every measurable indicator spells out the clear consequences of reckless runaway spending, Washington Democrats are showing no sign of changing course. President Biden's response to the shaky economy he created is to propose the biggest tax hike in American history and double-digit percentage growth in domestic discretionary spending. Democratic policies have working families deep in a financial hole, and our colleagues across the aisle just want to keep digging.
Clerk will call the roll.
Ms. Baldwin.
Madam President.
The Majority Leader.
Are we in a quorum?
Yeah.
I ask unanimous consent that the quorum be dispensed with.
Without objection.
Now, before I begin the substance of remarks today, I want to note how the Senate mourns the loss of one of its fine public servants. Senator Orrin Hatch, the longest-serving Republican in the history of the Senate, the sixth longest-serving member ever, passed away Saturday at the age of 88. Senator Hatch was a friend, a respected colleague, and a legislator of rare skill. In our 20 years serving together, our disagreements were frequent. They often ran deep. But I always knew him to be a person of good faith who put the needs of the state above all else, of his state above all else. While nobody ever mistook Senator Hatch for anything but a principled conservative, to his credit, he was never afraid to work with his Democratic colleagues when necessary to get things done, and he'd make compromises. I was in the room many times when it happened, and I will always admire him for that. The people of Utah lost a titan this weekend, one that will not likely come through this chamber again for a long time. My prayers and condolences go to all of Senator Hatch's family and friends, especially his wife Elaine and their six children and many, many grandchildren. May he forever rest in peace, and we thank him for his lifetime of public service. Today, Madam President, the Senate gavels in for the start of a five-week work period, and there's much, much that the American people want us and need us to work on in order to lower costs and improve their daily lives. That will be one of our primary focuses. The Senate will also continue confirming President Biden's administrative and judicial nominees. Today, we'll vote to advance the nomination of Lael Brainard to be Vice Chairman of the Federal Reserve Board of Governors. Ms. Brainard received bipartisan backing in the committee, and I expect her to sail through this chamber with similar bipartisan support. As soon as tomorrow, the Senate will proceed on the nomination of Lisa Cook to sit on the Federal Reserve Board of Governors. Coming from humble beginnings in rural Georgia, where her family fought racial segregation, Ms. Cook would make history as the first black woman ever to sit on the Federal Reserve Board of Governors. Her qualifications are irrefutable. She's a professor of economics at Michigan State, a member of the Federal Reserve Bank of Chicago Advisory Board, and served as senior economist in the President Obama's Council of Economic Advisors. In short, Ms. Cook absolutely belongs on the Fed, and I look forward to the Senate confirming her soon. This week, the Senate will also confirm Alvaro Bedoya as a commissioner on the Federal Trade Commission, breaking a 2-2 deadlock on the FTC that has lasted for over a year. Mr. Bedoya's confirmation is truly significant. If we want to lower costs, if we want to understand why the price of things like gasoline have surged, then it's important to break the 2-2 deadlock at the FTC so it can fully examine these issues and execute its agenda. Every time Americans go to the pump, they just know something truly rotten is going on with America's energy sector. Last year, the top 25 oil and gas companies reported $205 billion in profits. Earlier this month, ExxonMobil alone reported its highest quarterly profits since 2008. But has any of this translated into lower prices for Americans? Has any of this gone to help resolve our energy challenges? Has any of it gone to increasing worker productivity? No, no, and no. Instead, soaring energy profits have fueled soaring stock buybacks. In the fourth quarter of last year, oil and gas companies' stock buybacks rose by more than 2,000%. 2,000%. They're making record profits. And what do the CEOs do? They artificially increase the value of their stock simply by buying some of it back. That's not why stocks should go up. Could they do something to reduce prices? Wouldn't that help America more? Could they do something to make their oil companies, their workers fare better? No. There is something deeply wrong about seeing the largest oil and gas companies in the world drench top executives and wealthy shareholders with cash while Americans are struggling at the pump. That's why we need a fully functioning FTC as soon as possible, so it can look under the hood of America's energy sector and determine if rising prices are in part rooted in shady conduct. And I believe they are. For that reason, we must confirm Mr. Bedoya by the end of this week. And I'd say to my Republican friends, if you're complaining about oil and gas prices, gasoline prices, one of the best things to do is have the FTC take a look and propose action and act. On this very same note, Democrats are also discussing and will consider other potential action to beef up the FTC's ability to crack down on potential gas price manipulation. We'll have more to say on this as the week progresses. Madam President, also in the coming weeks, the Senate must make progress on several pressing legislative priorities. We must, for one, continue helping the people of Ukraine in their fight against Russian aggression. Last Thursday, President Biden announced the emergency funding Congress approved in March is close to running out, and he is expected to make another request to Congress later this week. 2 months into the war, Putin's hopes for a quick takeover have all but extinguished, thanks to the bravery of the Ukrainian people and to the aid that the U.S. and other countries have provided the Ukrainians in the form of javelins, stingers, and other critical weapons. But as we all know, the fight is far from over, and we must make sure the Ukrainian people continue to have the help they need for as long as they need it. Approving additional aid for Ukraine is a must, and I expect swift bipartisan cooperation to get it done. This morning, the President also announced he will nominate Bridget Brink to serve as the next ambassador to Ukraine. Ms. Brink's nomination is terrific news at a critical moment, and the Senate will prioritize her confirmation when she comes before the Senate and move her as quickly as possible. She is needed, and we will not tarry or delay. The United States has not had an ambassador within Ukraine since 2019, and Ms. Brink is an excellent choice to lead our diplomatic mission as we stand with the Ukrainian people. She's a longtime veteran of Eastern European affairs and has already been confirmed unanimously by the Senate to serve as ambassador to Slovakia. There is no reason both sides can't work together quickly and expeditiously to confirm Ms. Brink. In addition to Ukraine funding, I will also keep working with my colleagues to pass another bipartisan COVID funding package. At the end of the last work period, a group of Democrats and Republicans reached an agreement on a funding package, only for every single Republican to vote against moving forward. Every single one. Truly disappointing, because this funding is desperately needed. The best way to keep life as close to normal in case a new COVID variant arises is for Republicans to work with us to quickly approve more money for vaccines, more for testing, more money for life-saving therapeutics, and other urgent tools to fight the pandemic. The longer that that Senate Republicans hold out on working with us to approve new funding, the higher the cost will be for our country down the line. As we've learned already, it doesn't take much for a new variant to undo a lot of the progress we've made in recent months. So in the coming weeks, both parties must come to the table and reach a good faith agreement to move forward on COVID funding. It'll be vital for keeping schools, churches, businesses, and our communities open if and when a future, more potent variant rears its ugly head. Finally, this week, the Senate will also begin a formal conference committee with the House to finalize our jobs and competitiveness legislation. If there's anything that Republicans and Democrats should be able to agree on and move speedily on, it should certainly be a bipartisan bill that increases jobs, boosts innovation, and gets tough on the Chinese Communist Party while shoring up our chips manufacturing here at home. This legislation has been in the works for well over a year, and I know that members from both sides want to see us enter a conference as soon as we can. As the week progresses, Republicans must come to the table and show they're willing to work with us to finalize a vote to enter the conference. Both parties in both chambers have already announced their choices of who should serve as conferees, so the time has come to wrap up this process and begin a conference. I hope both sides will reach an accord soon so we can finish the year-long work of sending competitiveness legislation to the President's desk for his signature. Our economy and American consumers will be far, far better off for it. I yield the floor and note the absence of a quorum.
The clerk will call the roll.
Ms. Baldwin.
Madam President.
Senator from Texas.
Madam President, are we on a quorum call?
Yes, we are.
I'd ask consent that the quorum call be dispensed with.
Without objection.
Madam President, the Senate is now, of course, back in session following a two-week home work period, as we refer to it. That's when we get to go back home and see our friends and constituents and travel around our states. And in my case, representing 29 million Texans, that entails a fair amount of travel. But it's always good to get reconnected with your friends and your neighbors and your constituents. I know we're eager to hit the ground running here this week, and certainly we have a lot to do. For example, the conference committee process for the China Competitiveness Bill will begin soon, and I'm eager to work with the fellow members of the conference committee to reach a strong bipartisan bill. The long list of unrelated partisan provisions in the House bill, though, have no place, in my opinion, in the final agreement. But I'm ready to get the ball rolling so we can pass a bill that serves the American people, our economy, and most importantly, our national security. In the next couple of weeks, as we know, we could well see another pandemic relief bill come to the floor for a vote. I hope this package includes a piece of legislation that Senator Padilla, the senator from California, and I authored that would give state and local governments more flexibility to spend their excess COVID dollars, in this case on infrastructure or disaster relief. This bill passed the Senate unanimously and addresses a problem communities across our nation are facing. And there's no reason for it to be excluded from the larger package, so I'm optimistic. In the coming days, I hope the Senate will also take action to preserve the use of Title 42, the public health title addressing COVID-19, following the president's reckless decision to eliminate it with no alternative plan in place, which would invite even more chaos at our southern border. Months ago, during the height of COVID, the Border Patrol told me that Title 42 was helpful in repelling migrants who were not claiming asylum and avoiding having to process them on this side of the border. But that was one of the few things, given the huge number of asylum claims that were being made, that permitted them to control the flow of people across the border, at least in some manner. I'm proud to co-sponsor a bipartisan bill introduced by Senators Lankford and Senator Sinema, which would delay the end of Title 42 until there is a reasonable, workable alternative in place. There's bipartisan support for this legislation, and I hope it will receive a vote here on the Senate floor very soon. These are just a few of the items on the Senate's lengthy to-do list, but of course, the single biggest item looming in the news and on our minds and hearts is the war in Ukraine. Over the last 2 months, Ukraine has endured unimaginable suffering, and its brave people and soldiers continue to fight to save their country. As Americans, we cannot lose sight of our role in the conflict. Our sons and daughters are not on the front lines, nor are we obligated by a treaty like the North Atlantic Treaty to come to the aid of Ukraine. But I believe we have a moral responsibility to aid a fellow democracy against this kind of unprovoked and outrageous aggression. We can't just send money and weapons halfway around the world and then pat ourselves on the back and say, job well done. As I said, we have a moral responsibility to help Ukraine not only fight, but also to win this war. We can't just prop up its forces to continue to take more hits without providing them a plan for them to sustain their efforts in the long run. Over the last couple of months, folks across the political spectrum have united in support of Ukraine. Matter of fact, this has been one of the truly bipartisan responses that we've seen here in Congress, bipartisan support of Ukraine. I have to say, amid so much pain and suffering, it's been encouraging to see people around the world not just here in America, but around the world, stand shoulder to shoulder in support of Ukraine. As we know, since the war began, the United States has provided billions of dollars in military assistance, as well as humanitarian relief. This has come in the form of everything from body armor, to helmets, to ammunition, to Javelin anti-tank missiles. But as we know, more is needed. That was the message President Zelensky delivered to members of Congress. It was a message I heard from our partners in Europe when I traveled to Poland and Germany last month. And it's the same message we're hearing today. Send us the weapons we need to defend ourselves against this unprovoked and barbarous invasion by the Russian Federation. Daily, Ukrainian soldiers and civilians are being bludgeoned. We need to get them the resources they need to hold the line, and we need to continue to act with dispatch. Just before the state work period, the Senate passed legislation that would help make that more likely. It was called the Bipartisan Ukraine Lend-Lease Act, which I introduced with Senator Cardin. It has broad bipartisan support in the Senate, and it passed unanimously here earliest last month. This legislation is rooted in the same principle as the original Lend-Lease Act, which occurred during World War II, whereby the United States became what Franklin Delano Roosevelt called the arsenal of democracy. And we provided, at the time, up to $30 billion worth of materials, airplanes, ships, ammunition, all manner of weaponry, which allowed Great Britain to hang on against Nazi aggression. Now, if you translate the amount of assistance that the United States gave our allies in World War II under the Lend-Lease Act that was passed then and signed into law by Franklin Delano Roosevelt, it would translate into more than $400 billion today. And I think it's important for us to send a strong bipartisan message that the United States Congress supports Ukraine, not just for today, not just for tomorrow, but for the long run. Now that the Senate has unanimously passed this bipartisan legislation, it's up to the House. As I said, this legislation is important, one, because it cuts the red tape and expedites the shipment and delivery of weapons. As it stands today, there are a lot of time-consuming steps between the U.S. deciding to send more resources and to the forces on the ground, and between the time that the decision is made and the time that weapons are actually received. As we can see by the devastating videos of this war, there is no time for delay or red tape. Our assistance cannot move at the speed of the bureaucracy. And equally important is point number two. This bill ensures that we can send Ukraine the resources it actually needs, not just what current authorities allow. President Zelensky himself said, Ukraine can't shoot down Russian missiles with shotguns and machine guns. We need to listen to what Ukraine needs and send those items with dispatch. That's what this legislation provides for, nothing more and nothing less. It doesn't just help speed up the process of getting this equipment to Ukraine, it will ensure that we are actually sending them the items they actually need and can actually use. Now, I know I don't have to convince my Senate colleagues that this is a good piece of legislation. We passed it unanimously 2 weeks ago. So we all understand this, what's at stake, and we're eager to remove the hurdles that prevent the United States from arming Ukrainian forces with what they need to win this war as soon as we can get it in their hands. I hope our Senate colleagues and the American people will contact our colleagues in the House and encourage them to pass the Ukraine Democracy Lend-Lease Act this week. Every day we're learning more about the horrors unfolding in Ukraine. We've seen Russian war crimes in Bucha, and there are well-founded fears that the same carnage is unfolding in Mariupol. These developments should light a fire under our colleagues in the House to pass this legislation as soon as possible. Chris Alexander is a former Canadian diplomat who spent time posted at the Canadian embassy in Russia. He recently said Lend-Lease is a potential game changer in the war in Ukraine. A potential game changer. There's no better way to describe this legislation or to underscore its urgency. Last week, the Ukrainian Prime Minister himself said that our Lend-Lease program is what Ukraine needs to win the war. Over the last 2 months, Ukrainian forces have demonstrated unbelievable strength and bravery. So it's time once again for the United States to serve as that arsenal of democracy, as Franklin Roosevelt called it, and ensure that Ukraine has the full range of resources it needs, not just for today, not for just for tomorrow, but for the future as well. After this bill passed the Senate, Ukraine's Minister for Foreign Affairs expressed his gratitude to all 100 senators who voted to pass the bill. And he said he looks forward to its swift passage in the House. So I would respectfully encourage Speaker Pelosi to bring this legislation to the floor for a vote this week so we can answer Ukraine's call to provide more weapons more quickly for the indefinite future. Madam President, I yield the floor, and I'd note the absence of a quorum.
The clerk will call the roll.
Ms. Baldwin.
The Majority Leader.
I ask unanimous consent the quorum be dispensed with.
Without objection.
I move to proceed to legislative session.
The question is on the motion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. The ayes appear to have it. The ayes do have it. The motion is agreed to.
I move to proceed to executive session to consider calendar 800.
The question is on the motion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no. The ayes appear to have it. The ayes do have it. The motion is agreed to. The clerk will report.
Nomination of the Judiciary, Sherilyn Peace Garnett of California to be United States District Judge for the Central District of California.
I send a cloture motion to the desk.
Clerk will report.
Cloture motion. We, the undersigned senators, in accordance with the provisions of Rule 22 of the Standing Rules of the Senate, do hereby move to bring to a close debate on the nomination of Executive Calendar Number 800, Sherilyn Peace Garnett of California, to be United States District Judge for the Central District of California, signed by 17 senators as follows.
I ask consent the reading of the names be waived.
Without objection.
I move to proceed to legislative session.
The question is on the motion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. The ayes appear to have it. The ayes do have it. The motion is agreed to.
I move to proceed to executive session to consider calendar 865.
Question is on the motion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. The ayes have it. The motion is agreed to. Clerk will report.
Nomination, Department of Housing and Urban Development, Julia Ruth Gordon of Maryland to be an Assistant Secretary.
Motion to the desk.
Clerk will report.
Cloture motion. We, the undersigned senators, in accordance with the provisions of Rule 22 of the Standing Rules of the Senate, do hereby move to bring to a close debate on the nomination of Executive Calendar Number 865, Julia Ruth Gordon of Maryland, to be an Assistant Secretary of Housing and Urban Development, signed by 17 senators as follows.
I ask consent the reading of the names be waived.
Without objection.
I move to proceed to legislative session.
Question is on the motion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. The ayes appear to have it. The ayes do have it. The motion is agreed to.
I move to proceed to executive session to consider calendar 670.
Question is on the motion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no. The ayes appear to have it. The ayes do have it. The motion is agreed to. The clerk will report.
Nomination, Department of Labor, Lisa M. Gomez of New Jersey to be an Assistant Secretary.
I send a cloture motion to the desk.
Clerk will report.
Cloture motion. We, the undersigned senators, in accordance with the provisions of Rule 22 of the Standing Rules of the Senate, do hereby move to bring to a close debate on the nomination of Executive Calendar Number 670, Lisa M. Gomez of New Jersey, to be an Assistant Secretary of Labor, signed by 17 senators as follows.
I ask consent the reading of the names be waived.
Without objection.
Finally, I ask unanimous consent that the mandatory quorum calls for the cloture motions filed today, April 25th, be waived.
Without objection.
Okay.
The clerk will report the motion to invoke cloture.
Cloture motion. We, the undersigned senators, in accordance with the provisions of Rule 22 of the Standing Rules of the Senate, do hereby move to bring to a close the debate on the nomination of Executive Calendar Number 808, Lael Brainard of the District of Columbia, to be Vice Chairman of the Board of Governors of the Federal Reserve System for a term of 4 years.
By unanimous consent, the mandatory quorum call has been waived. The question is it the sense of the Senate that debate on the nomination of Lael Brainard of the District of Columbia to be Vice Chair of the Board of Governors of the Federal Reserve System shall be brought to a close? The yeas and nays are mandatory under the rule. The clerk will call the roll.
Ms. Baldwin, Mr. Barrasso, Mr. Bennett, Mrs. Blackburn, Mr. Blumenthal, Mr. Blunt, Mr. Booker, Mr. Bozeman, Mr. Braun, Mr. Brown, Mr. Burr, Ms. Cantwell, Mrs. Capito, Mr. Cardin, Mr. Carper, Mr. Casey, Mr. Cassidy, Mr. Collins, Ms. Collins, Mr. Coons, Mr. Cornyn, Ms. Cortez Masto, Mr. Cotton. Mr. Kramer. Mr. Crapo. Mr. Cruz. Mr. Daines. Ms. Duckworth. Mr. Durbin. Ms. Ernst. Mrs. Feinstein. Mrs. Fisher. Mrs. Gillibrand. Mr. Graham. Mr. Grassley. Mr. Haggerty. Ms. Hassan. Mr. Hawley. Mr. Heinrich. Mr. Hickenlooper. Ms. Hirono. Mr. Hoven. Mrs. Hyde Smith. Mr. Inhofe. Mr. Johnson. Mr. Kane. Mr. Kelly. Mr. Kennedy. Mr. King. Ms. Klobuchar. Mr. Lankford. Mr. Leahy. Mr. Lee. Mr. Lujan. Ms. Lummis. Mr. Manchin. Mr. Markey. Mr. Marshall. Mr. McConnell. Mr. Menendez. Mr. Merkley. Mr. Moran. Ms. Murkowski. Mr. Murphy. Mrs. Murray. Mr. Ossoff. Mr. Padilla. Mr. Paul. Mr. Peters. Mr. Portman. Mr. Reed. Mr. Risch. Mr. Romney. Ms. Rosen. Mr. Rounds. Mr. Rubio. Mr. Sanders. Mr. Sass. Mr. Schatz. Mr. Schumer. Mr. Scott of Florida. Mr. Scott of South Carolina. Mrs. Shaheen. Mr. Shelby. Ms. Cinema. Ms. Smith. Ms. Stabenow. Mr. Sullivan. Mr. Tester. Mr. Thune. Mr. Tillis. Mr. Toomey. Mr. Tuberville. Mr. Van Hollen. Mr. Warner. Mr. Warnock. Ms. Warren. Mr. Whitehouse. Mr. Wicker. Mr. Wyden. Mr. Young. Senators voting in the affirmative. Cardin, Gillibrand, Graham, King, Leahy, Schatz, and Sinema. Senators voting in the negative. Cotton, Daines, Fisher, Grassley, Lee, Marshall, Romney, and Tillis. Mr. Manchin, Mr. Manchin, aye. Mrs. Blackburn, Mrs. Blackburn, no. Mr. Kelly, Mr. Kelly, aye. Mr.
Mr. Hickenlooper. Mr. Hickenlooper, aye. Mr. Wyden. Mr. Wyden, aye. Mrs. Feinstein. Mrs. Feinstein, aye. Mr. Kane, Mr. Kane, aye. Mr. Warner, Mr. Warner, aye. Ms. Lummis, aye. Mr. Tuberville, no. Mr. Carper, Mr. Carper, aye. Mr. Toomey, Mr. Toomey, no. Mr. Rounds, aye. Mr. Reed, aye. Mr. Lujan, aye. Ms. Cantwell, aye. Mr. Shelby, no. Mr. Risch, no. Mr. Sass, no. Mr. Hoven, no. Mr. Braun, no. Mr. Scott of South Carolina, no. Mr. Scott of Florida, no. Mr. Van Hollen, aye. Mrs. Shaheen, aye. Mr. Wicker, no. Mr. Ossoff, aye. Mr. Crapo, aye. Mr. Rubio, no. Mr. Menendez. Mr. Menendez, aye. Mr. Cassidy. Mr. Cassidy, no. Ms. Hassan, Ms. Hassan, aye. Ms. Klobuchar, Ms. Klobuchar, aye. Ms. Collins, aye. Ms. Smith, aye. Mr. Sanders, aye. Mr. Young, aye. Mr. Hawley, no. Mrs. Hyde-Smith, no. Mr. Haggerty, aye. Mr. Paul, no. Mr. Bennett, aye. Mr. Tester, aye. Ms. Baldwin. Ms. Baldwin, aye. Mr. Brown. Mr. Brown, aye. Ms. Cortez Masto. Ms. Cortez Masto, aye. Mr. Booker. Mr. Booker, aye. Mr. Cornyn. Mr. Cornyn, no. Mr. Kramer. Mr. Kramer, no. Mrs. Capito. Mrs. Capito, no. Ms. Ernst, Ms. Ernst, no. Ms. Warren, Ms. Warren, aye. Mr. Durbin, aye. Mr. Barrasso, no. Ms. Stabenow, aye. Mr. Merkley, aye. Mr. Portman, no. Mr. Blunt, no. Mr. Heinrich, aye. Mr. Thune, no. Mr. Whitehouse, aye. Ms. Duckworth, aye. Ms. Hirono, aye. Mr. Burr, no. Mr. Kennedy, Mr. Kennedy, no. Mr. Inhofe, no. Mr. Johnson, no. Mr. Cruz, no. Ms. Rosen, Ms. Rosen, aye. Mr. Schumer, aye. Mr. Bozeman, no. Mr. Murphy, aye. Mr. Langford, no. Mr. Markey. Mr. Markey, aye. Mr. Blumenthal. Mr. Blumenthal, aye. Mr. McConnell. Mr. McConnell, no. Mr. Padilla. Mr. Padilla, aye. Mr. Warnock. Mr. Warnock, aye. Mr. Sullivan, aye.
On this vote, the yeas are 54, the nays are 40, and the motion is agreed to.
Mr. President.
Senator from Ohio.
I'm coming on the floor again this evening to talk about the tragedy that's unfolding in Ukraine. This is the ninth week in a row during sessions that I have come to the floor to talk about the brutal and unprovoked Russian invasion of Ukraine. Ukraine, an ally of ours, a democratic country, and a sovereign country. It's now been more than 2 months since Russia's assault began, and Ukrainians continue to fight with heart, with toughness, and conviction. The Russians have been defeated in Kyiv, the capital of Ukraine, and the Russian Black Sea flagship, the Moskva, was sunk by Ukrainian Neptune missiles. So there have been some successes. But while Ukraine and its people have impressed the free world with their fierce defense of their homeland, the senseless and indiscriminate killing of Ukrainian civilians by Russia continues. In this new stage of the war, Russia has begun an intensified offensive in the Donbas region, in the eastern part of Ukraine. A few days ago, a Russian commander affirmed that their goal is to gain full control of Donetsk and Luhansk Oblast, meaning control of all of the Donbas in eastern Ukraine, rather than the roughly 50% they took in 2014, and control of southern Ukraine, cutting Ukraine off from its Black Sea ports, leaving one of the world's most important exporters landlocked. The commander also threatened the territorial integrity of the small country of Moldova that borders southern Ukraine by saying this would connect Russia to the breakaway province of Transnistria, where Russian troops are already stationed. It may not be coincidental that today we heard reports of bombs hitting the Ministry of State building in Transnistria, when no one was there, by the way. Some say this could be a false flag attack, giving Russia an excuse to invade all of Moldova. All the countries in the region are nervous about their status. They're worried for a good reason. They could be next. I can see why they're concerned. We have all seen with our own eyes what's going on television or online, videos we've seen. But let's not forget, Russia continues to commit war crimes and display an utter disregard for innocent human lives. They continue to prevent evacuation of civilians from Mariupol. They've executed non-combatants, and now there are reports of systemic rape and torture by Russian soldiers. This is on top of previous confirmed reports of the use of cluster munitions and thermobaric weapons on civilians. As of February 28, the International Criminal Court announced allegations would be investigated. That's good. That must happen. But if they wait and have the proceedings once the war is over, in my view, that is too late. The perpetrators must be brought to justice. These horrific Russian assaults on innocent Ukrainian families in Bucha, Mariupol, and elsewhere, the bombing of civilian targets, the rapes, the tortures, all these are crimes against humanity. And Russia must be held accountable for war crimes, not later, but now. If there's not accountability, more senseless killings in Ukraine will occur, and these atrocities are likely to be repeated by others in the future. Many of my colleagues and I were on a video call today with the Ukrainian Prime Minister, Denis Shmyhal. He expressed his appreciation for the lethal support we have provided here in the United States Senate and in the House and through the administration. But he stressed the need for more help, for more heavy weapons to defend and push Russia back in the Donbas region. He also detailed how the country's economy has been severely damaged and what they will need just to stay afloat. Regarding military assistance, I'm pleased that this past week, the White House heeded calls from a bipartisan group of us to appoint a Ukraine Security Assistance Coordinator to cut through the red tape and get the right military assistance to Ukraine more quickly. It is important with so many agencies and individuals involved that one person be solely focused on this critical mission and be held accountable. That person, the White House has appointed, is three-star General Terry Wolf, who has extensive experience as the former Deputy Special Presidential Envoy for the Global Coalition to Counter ISIL and has commanded every level, from platoon to armored division. From the very start of this conflict, I've said we need to do more and we need to do it more quickly. We cannot do that if our assistance gets bogged down by the bureaucracy. Every delay in lethal aid costs Ukrainian lives. So I'm pleased we now have a coordinator, and I hope that this will streamline the process. I'm encouraged that the administration also recently announced further assistance of $800 million in artillery pieces, ammunition, armored vehicles, and new loitering munition. It's called the Phoenix Ghost. This is a suicidal drone that is now in the hands of the Ukrainians. That's promising. I understand that the $3.4 billion in security assistance Congress passed in March will soon be exhausted, and that there will be a need for additional supplemental funding for Ukraine. I encourage the administration to go ahead and look at that package, send it to us, get us start thinking about it, because when it comes here for a vote, I think we need to act quickly on it, review what the administration has sent, and be sure we do it on a standalone basis rather than having it get bogged down in unrelated legislative matters. I'm also pleased that some state National Guards are sending armored vehicles to assist Ukraine in their efforts. From Ohio, our National Guard will provide some M113 armored personnel carriers as part of a drawdown of DoD inventories to support Ukraine. This sends a strong message of support to our allies from the Buckeye State. I also appreciate the number of police departments across Ohio, including the Cleveland Police Department, where I was last week, are providing over 200 protective vests to Ukrainians. Thank you. Last week, I had the chance to visit an incredibly effective nonprofit in Ohio called MedWish that collects donated medical supplies from hospitals and provides these medical supplies to countries who are in need, sometimes because of a natural disaster, in this case, because of war. Today, their major focus is on Ukraine, where they have delivered over 7 tons of badly needed medical supplies. And this effort continues. Again, I thank them for what they're doing. I thank all the hospitals and all the private practices that have donated equipment to be able to be sent to Ukraine to save lives. As we all know, this war continues to produce a staggering number of refugees. Last week, the White House announced the program Uniting for Ukraine to streamline the process for bringing 100,000 refugees with strong ties to the United States into our country. Uniting for Ukraine will allow Americans and organizations here to sponsor Ukrainians who have been forced to leave their country. The American sponsors will be required to declare their financial support for the applicants, and the Ukrainians applying for this program must meet vaccinations and other public health requirements, as well as biographic and biometric screening, vetting, and security checks. That's all good. These individuals will then be allowed to work and remain in the U.S. legally for up to 2 years. I have heard personally from so many generous Ohioans who want to open up their homes to these refugees, who want to be helpful. More than 500 people have now called or emailed my office, and a number of businesses have expressed interest in offering jobs to these refugees. I urge the administration to quickly staff up this program so that we can bring some of these desperate refugees to the United States as planned. Unfortunately, I'm finding out that there is no online portal yet, no way for people to be able to know how they can participate in this process. So my hope is that we will launch this online portal with applications soon so that folks who want to sponsor Ukrainians fleeing the war are able to do so. I wish this was done sooner, but this is a step in the right direction. Our partners in Europe are doing more than their fair share here. More than 5 million Ukrainians have fled their homeland since the war began, and they're crossing borders into their neighboring countries in Europe. As I saw when I was in Poland last month, meeting with refugees, Poland has taken in almost 3 million refugees alone. I think Poland is to be commended with the way they have responded to this Ukrainian crisis in so many respects, including taking these refugees. We saw cars lined up at the refugee processing center down at the border of everyday Poles who were there to pick up Ukrainian refugees and to take them into their home. Hungary and Slovakia have taken in hundreds of thousands too. Surely the United States can get our act together with regard to the 100,000. I'm pleased that Secretaries Blinken and Austin met with President Zelensky yesterday in Kyiv. This is the first time since the war began 2 months ago that we've had American diplomats in Kyiv, and I think it's important that we are there. The Europeans are there. Other countries are there. We need to be there too. I'm glad to hear that we are finally reestablishing our diplomatic presence in Kyiv, and I'm also pleased that the administration is finally nominating an ambassador to Ukraine. We've had no ambassador to Ukraine during this administration. They have indicated they're going to nominate Bridget Brink, who's a career Foreign Service officer and is the current U.S. ambassador to Slovakia. So she has some critical experience in the area. While both of these moves were long overdue, I commend the administration for finally acting, sending a strong signal to our allies and adversaries alike that the United States is serious about standing with Ukraine. Let's get our diplomats back to the capital, back to Kyiv, and let's get an ambassador in place as soon as possible. On the sanctions front, I believe we should be seizing, not just freezing, assets of Kremlin supporters and provide the funds from the sale of these assets to meet the needs of Ukraine. To do this, I introduced with Senator Bennett of Colorado the Repurposing Elite Luxuries into Emergency Funds Relief Act for Ukraine to require the Department of Justice to direct any funds resulting from the disposal of seized Russian assets to support Ukrainian refugees and support reconstruction. So like other countries have done, including France and Germany, let's seize these assets, like yachts owned by the Kremlin supporters or by President Putin himself, and then take those funds on the sale of those assets and use them immediately to help with the humanitarian effort. I urge the Senate and the House to act this week on this legislation so that we can give Ukrainians the help they need. I continue to believe our top priority on sanctions should be cutting off Russia's number one source of income that fuels the war machine. 40% to 50% of their budget is from one place, energy. Those receipts from energy are fueling the Putin war machine. Energy is Russia's largest export and accounts, again, for a significant part, roughly half of their budget. Over the past year, the average oil revenues going back to Russia from their exports to the United States alone was $50 million a day. Under pressure from Congress, the administration reversed course and supported blocking Russian oil, natural gas, and coal imports into the United States. I'm glad we did that. It made no sense for us to help fund the Russian war effort, especially when we have our own resources here in terms of energy that we can access. I welcome the President's announcement in Brussels of the creation of a joint U.S.-EU task force to help reduce Europe's dependency on Russian energy and strengthened Europe's energy security. Europe has become much more dependent on Russia for energy than the United States. Germany now gets almost 40% of its natural gas from Russia. This means that Europe, by the way, is now sending an estimated $870 million a day to Russia, $870 million a day in payments for its natural gas, oil, and coal from Russia. Ending that European reliance on Russian energy is the right policy, and it will save lives. Fortunately, again, some progress has been made. The EU has agreed to phase out imports of Russian coal over time, they say over the next several months. They've said that they're willing to work with the United States to have some of our liquefied natural gas, LNG, replace some of the Russian gas. This is a good idea. We should allow more production here in the United States so we have that LNG to be able to export to Germany and to other European countries to replace some of that Russian gas, to make them less dependent on Russia and to stop sending this revenue to fund the war machine. Lithuania needs to be held up as the first European Union country to completely cut itself off from Russian natural gas. But the reality, again, is that Europe continues to fund the war machine right now with this $870 million every day in energy receipts going to Russia. Part of the answer, again, lies with us. We must support our domestic energy producers as a means of supporting our national and economic security, but also as a way to support our allies. This means America having a robust, all-of-the-above approach to power our nation, which includes hydrogen, renewables, fossil fuels, carbon capture technologies, nuclear power, hydropower. The importance of this cannot be overstated. Energy is national security. As a practical matter, to stop the revenues going from Europe to fund the Russian war machine, the administration must change policies to get more American LNG to Europe to substitute for Russian gas. This requires more pipelines, more infrastructure, more export facilities, of course. Unfortunately, we aren't off to a very good start on that front. The President's tax proposals released with his recent budget submission to Congress eliminates important tax provisions used by our domestic producers, like the deduction for intangible drilling costs, or IDCs, which allows natural gas and oil producers to deduct costs that are necessary for the drilling and preparation of wells. Let's take an approach here where we're encouraging, again, all of the above in order to ensure our national security and to help our allies in Europe. The ruble has just about fully recovered to its pre-invasion value because Russia is still bringing in these revenues from the sale of its energy. Shares on Russia's stock market are trading again, and Russia's VTB Bank remains open for business in Europe, where it has gathered billions of euros in deposits, mainly from German savers. Our sanctions have left Russia's biggest economic lifeline largely untouched, again, energy sales, specifically to Europe. In fact, in addition to cutting off the natural gas and the revenue that fuels the Russian war machine, we need to tighten up bank sanctions as they relate to energy. Sanctions for energy transactions don't go into effect against Russian banks, including the VTB Bank, until June 24th. Those sanctions ought to go into place right now. They should have gone into place weeks ago. President Biden must lead the alliance to do what it takes to help Ukraine win, and the administration needs to make clear that their objective is for Ukraine to actually be victorious, to push the forces of Russia out of the sovereign territory of Ukraine. We must remember that the Ukrainians are not asking us to fight for them, but they are asking for the tools to defend themselves, so they have a chance to win. I've said before that both Ukraine and Georgia should be given what is called membership action plan as a next step toward NATO membership. Based on the actions of the Russians and the fighting spirit of the Ukrainians, I now feel more strongly than ever that Ukraine should be part of NATO. They deserve it. I'm encouraged that both Finland and Sweden are considering NATO membership. They should both be immediately welcomed into the NATO family. Vladimir Putin sought to weaken the NATO alliance. This is yet another strategic failure on his part, as we are coming closer together and will potentially add even more members. I will close with this thought. Some might ask, even a few of my colleagues have asked me, why a senator from Ohio cares about what goes on in Ukraine. Well, the first answer is we should all care. This is about the fight for freedom in our time, in our generation. This is where it's being engaged right now. I also happen to have tens of thousands of Ukrainians who call Ohio home. These Ukrainian Americans are good friends of mine. They're constituents. They keep me informed and have over the years. They've helped me to get more engaged on this issue. I've been to Ukraine 6 or 7 times. When I was at the border of Ukraine and Poland last month, some of my Ohio friends were there too, as volunteers, providing food and medical supplies to the refugees. When Ukraine made a decision to turn to us, to turn to democracy and freedom and free enterprise back in 2014, I was there with my colleague Ben Cardin, Democrat from Maryland. We were there as election observers. But what we really observed was a country that had made a decision to turn to us, to turn to the West, to be like us, to join us in the fight for freedom. Even if I had no constituents of Ukrainian descent, I would be standing here because this is the fight for freedom. This is our test. Are we going to stand against tyranny and for freedom at a time when these terrible atrocities are being committed? I've been to the border of Ukraine and Poland and talked to these refugees. Through their tears, they spoke of their apartments or homes being destroyed and damaged. They talked of friends and family members being injured or killed. They talked of the pain of being separated from their husbands or fathers, not knowing their fate since they had stayed behind to fight. They also begged us to put in place a no-fly zone to help them even more. The popular Ukrainian national rallying cry, Slava Ukraini, when translated into English, is glory to Ukraine. And then the response to that is glory to the heroes, Heroyam Slava. In the midst of all this, there are so many heroes to glorify in Ukraine. Heroes like the people I saw in Ohio last week who work at MedWish and are providing medical supplies urgently needed in Ukraine. The staff that collect and send these much-needed supplies, going mostly to the women and children of Ukraine who continue to seek safe passage from their homeland. Not only are there heroes here, but there are so many heroes at home in Ukraine. Those are the firefighters. Those are the soldiers. Those are the citizen soldiers. With our help, the Ukrainians can win this war. One of the members of parliament from Ukraine, from the Rada, who came to see us a few weeks ago here in Congress, perhaps said it best. We met with the Ukrainian caucus that I co-chair, and we had 4 members of the Rada come, all women, and the ambassador from Ukraine was there as well. They said, she hears all the time that, quote, we are all Ukrainians now. And I've heard that back home. And that's how I feel. She said that if that is true, since we're all Ukrainians now, we must be like Ukrainians. She said we must be brave, creative, and fast. And that's what they are. They're very resourceful. They've figured out a way to take on one of the biggest armies of the world and be successful, brave, creative, and fast. I urge my colleagues, the administration, and the world, let us help Ukraine win this war by being brave, creative, and fast. By doing that, we will show the world America stands with Ukraine, which is in our national security interest. Thank you. I yield the floor.
The senator from Ohio.
Thank you. I thank the other senator for Ohio. Thank Senator Portman for his work in Ukraine. I was at the with the Ukrainian group over the last week or so and talked about the work Senator Portman's done, and also talked about how Putin has just been shocked by the passion and the effectiveness and the strength and the courage of the Ukrainian opposition, surely. And also, Putin's been shocked by President Biden's skill at putting together this coalition in opposition to the Russians. The Germany, who hadn't really played in an exercise like this, in an action like this in decades, and Sweden and Finland and Switzerland, countries that simply were neutral. And I appreciate Senator Portman's work on that and the President of the United States. And it's why we're doing a reasonably good job as a world community at helping with refugees who have gone to Poland and Moldova and other areas, while we're getting arms to them, while we're doing damage to the Ukraine, to the Russian economy, and we'll continue to do that. So I thank my friend from Cincinnati. Mr. President, asked to unanimously to put this, the following remarks in a different place in the record.
Without objection.
I thank the presiding officer, Senator from Mexico. I urge my colleagues in joining me in voting to confirm the nominations of Lael Brainard to the Vice Chair of the Board of Governors of the Federal Reserve System and Lisa Cook to be a member of the Board of Governors of the Federal Reserve. Dr. Brainard and Dr. Cook are highly qualified economists with decades of experience, having provided exemplary service to their profession and to this country. Since 2014, Dr. Brainard has served as a member of the Board of Governors of the Federal Reserve. She's helped oversee the Fed's important financial stability work. She's worked to create a better payment system that works for consumers and for small banks. Prior to serving on the Fed, Dr. Brainard was Undersecretary for International Affairs at Treasury, where she played a critical role in helping support our country's recovery from the Wall Street-induced financial crisis in 2008. She has a long history of bipartisan support and bipartisan work. She served in his administration of both parties. She was Deputy National Economic Advisor in the Clinton administration. She was a staff economist at the Council of Economic Advisors during the first George Bush administration. And in between her public service to our country, she served as professor of applied economics at one of the nation's great institutions, the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. Throughout this distinguished career, Dr. Brainard has been not just a good economist, but she's been a persistent advocate for working families and for communities who have been left on their own for too long. She understands the role of government and the role of the Federal Reserve should be, not always successful in getting them there. I think these new nominees will do that. But putting workers at the center of our economy, putting the workers at the center of our financial regulatory system, putting workers at the center of what we do here. She led the way in modernizing and strengthening the Community Reinvestment Act, a landmark civil rights law passed to begin undoing the legacy of redlining and lending discrimination, spurring investments in neighborhoods and communities. CRA has fallen short in many times, partly because of the last administration and the damage it did. But the CRA is, we are breathing new life into the CRA. Dr. Brainard has done a good job at keeping it alive and setting the stage. She led decisive bipartisan action to use the Fed's emergency lending and monetary policy tools to support families through the COVID-19 crisis. Like Dr. Brainard, Dr. Cook is a leading economist with years of research and international experience in monetary policy, banking, and financial crises. She knows that workers drive our economic growth. She knows how important their local communities are. Dr. Cook spent her formative years in the South, growing up in Milledgeville, Georgia. She spent a significant portion of her career in the industrial Midwest. She's seen how economic policy set here and economic policy set at the Federal Reserve. She's seen how that policy affects all kinds of different people in different parts of the country. She graduated from Spelman College, one of the great institutions in this country. She was a Marshall Scholar and a Truman Scholar. Who do we know that are both of those things? Chose both very exclusive honors and academic disciplines. She studied at Oxford University. She earned a PhD in economics, again, from one of our great institutions in this country, the University of California at Berkeley. She's a tenured professor of economics and international relations at one of the great institutions in my part of the country, Michigan State University. She taught at the Harvard Kennedy School of Government. She served on the Council of Economic Advisors during the Eurozone crisis and at the Department of the Treasury. Yet, Mr. Chairman, Mr. President, despite her extensive experience, despite her broad support, a small but really, really loud minority far outside the mainstream have engaged in a smear campaign against Dr. Cook. It's emblematic of the sorts of attacks that black and brown Americans, particularly women, have encountered for far too long here. I won't go through what's happened in my committee. I chair the Committee on Banking, Housing, and Urban Affairs. I won't lay out for for one thing, the senators on my side of the aisle know it. The senators on their side of the aisle don't want to think about it. What's happened with black, very, very qualified, accomplished black women coming out of my committee and how few Republicans have voted for them. I mean, count one after another, they get zero votes or one votes or two, one vote or two votes out of 12. Women, and certainly black women, know all too well what it's like to be called inexperienced when you're anything but. They know what it's like to be told your qualifications are never enough, no matter how extensive they are, no matter how impressive they are. These naysayers wrongly claim that Lisa Cook doesn't meet the standards for this position, standards that only seem to apply for certain nominees. Like the game of whack-a-mole, each time these assertions and allegations are rebutted, and each time they are effectively rebutted, a new, more untethered one arises. She's unquestionably qualified. Dr. Lisa Cook is unquestionably qualified. If confirmed, she would be the first black woman ever in the 100-plus year history of the Fed to serve on its board. Think of that. 1913, the Fed started. 109 years later, seven people, not one person on the Fed, not one chair, seven people on the Fed at most times, but seven spots on the Fed. She'll be the first black woman ever in 109 years. Think about that. Dr. Cook, Dr. Brainard will be excellent additions to the Fed. We need them on the job now as Americans face rising prices caused by corporate greed and a global pandemic and Putin's war. Having a full board has never been more vital than now. I urge my colleagues to join me in supporting Dr. Lael Brainard and Dr. Lisa Cook, their nomination, so they can get to work for the American people. I yield the floor, Mr. President. President.
The senator from Ohio.
Thank you, Mr. President. I ask unanimous consent the Senate proceed to legislative session and be in a period of morning business, with senators permitted to speak therein for up to 10 minutes each.
Without objection.
Mr. President, I ask unanimous consent that the appointments of the desk appear separately in the record as if made by the chair.
Without objection.
Mr. President, I ask unanimous consent when the Senate completes its business today and adjourns until 10 a.m. on Tuesday, April 26th, that following the prayer and pledge, the morning hour be deemed expired, the Journal of Proceedings be approved to date, the time for the two leaders be reserved for their use later in the day, and morning business be closed. that upon the conclusion of morning business, the Senate proceed to executive session to resume consideration of the Brainard nomination post-cloture, that the Senate recess from 12:30 until 2:15 to allow for the weekly caucus meetings, and that 2:15 the Senate vote on confirmation of the Brainard nomination. Finally, if any nominations are confirmed during Tuesday's session, the motions to reconsider be considered made and laid upon the table, and the President be immediately notified of the Senate's action.
Without objection.
Mr. President, if there's no further business come before the Senate, I ask that you stand adjourned until the end of the previous order.
Senate stands adjourned until 10 o'clock tomorrow morning.